basing conservation in science is critical. The ecology of the entire globe has so many pressures on it. So what the garden is doing is trying to figure out solutions to these global problems.
Conservation is a big, multifaceted issue to tackle. We need a lot of tools in our toolbox, and it's easy to think about conserving things as just saving them, protecting them, and we do that here, but we need to do more than that. We know that just creating a library for a rainy day is not enough. We need to go out into natural systems and actively repair them. I view restoration as just a completely integral part of conservation.
Habitat restoration isn't really that old of a field, and so we're still learning what works best, and that's a great role for the garden to, when we're doing this work, test different things, and that makes all the other restoration that's done stronger.
The garden has a long history of observational science. More recently, we've really started to do more experimental science, manipulating the environment so that we can understand how those systems work.
All the science that we do at the garden is in line with our mission, meaning that it has to have a clear impact on the conservation, recovery, and restoration of California's ecosystems. All of our science has a purpose and an application, and we want it to be fed into management decisions that change landscapes and make conservation impacts.
At Elings Park, we had a range of invasive species that we had to deal with. They've been well established over the last 100 years. And so our goal was to first understand the best way to remove those invasive plants.
We used two different methods to try and get rid of the non-native plants in that acre. Tarping, so setting this black tarp over everything, which solarizes a lot of the weeds underneath it. And then the other method is sheet mulching. So basically laying a bunch of cardboard out and then covering it with mulch.
So far the mulching is winning by far, both because it's controlled the weeds better, but also because the nutrients that it's introducing is really helping the plants grow. The tarping didn't work as well as we had hoped that it would. We had the tarps on for several months and there were plenty of hot weather in that time, but it wasn't at the hottest time of year. And so we had a lot of the annual grasses come back in, but it's kind of a push-pull between all of the different factors. I would say that the mulching took a lot more time than the tarping did because of all of the gathering of the cardboard and all the transporting of the mulch, a lot less prep for the tarping, but then a whole lot more weeding in the tarped areas after. So we're gonna have to gather all the data and then do the math. And the idea is to report the results for all of these different things so that another organization might have this priority or that priority, and they can choose which method is best for their priorities.
In addition to our site where we are actively performing restoration, we do have a control site. And the purpose of a control site is to tell you what your experimental site would look like without your intervention.
And the control site is nearby this acre of restoration. It's just the non-native stuff that was left there. That control site gets impacted by the goats? Sheep, I knew it. Get them wrong every time.
So it was actually mowed down pretty well by the sheep. They did a fantastic job. But I would actually argue that it is still a control site because had we not had our restoration site with a fence around it, the sheep would have gone through there exactly the same way. Our site really would look like the control site.
Well, we really want to make sure that we do a good job at restoring habitats, that we're really making sure that we're supporting the whole food web. And at the garden, it's unique that we look not just at the plants, but we look at the bugs, which are really great ambassadors because they're so diverse. They do so many jobs in the ecosystem. We can really ask if it's working.
Conservation of native plants helps the conservation of native birds and native insects. Or thinking about that web of life again, all of these things that depend on each other, if you're going to conserve one group, you have to try and conserve the other groups so that codependency is conserved. Part of the restoration experiment is comparing how the two different weed control methods we're using affect the animal communities differently, particularly the soil inverts. And then the above ground questions are, how does the planting of these native plants affect the insect communities that are using the plants, specifically caterpillars, compared to the insect communities that are using the non-native control areas that we're not restoring.
Restoration is very complicated, and this is where we get into that whole web of life. But in addition to all the connections to living things, we also have interactions with abiotic or non-living factors. So the local weather, the soil nutrition, the soil type, all these nuances play into whether plants are successful in a given place.
At Elings Park, we were concerned with the soil health because it had been farmed and really impacted. And so we took some initial samples to try and get a gauge of the health of the soil. To do that, we did a few different tests. Number one, we collected samples and we actually sent them out to a lab to learn about the total organic content in the soil. Our lab results came back and the soil had very little organic content. It's very dense, very compacted, not the best soil.
And maybe people think of soil as dead all the time, but healthy soil is very much a living thing. And so this helps us see what kind of health the soil is in. And so looking at it, especially between these plots that we put down cardboard and mulch, and then plots where we didn't, I'm really interested to see, like, does adding this organic material that will break down over time, does this help feed the organisms?
We expect that the soil health is going to be vastly improved in the area that we're transforming, especially in the mulched area where we're bringing in nutrients like carbon and nitrogen and phosphorus and increasing the fertility of the soil, but then also allowing the water to infiltrate instead of running off so that we don't have a lot of erosion and we're contributing to the groundwater. So there's a variety of things that we're monitoring in terms of soil health.
In early 2024, we planted over 1,300 plants, and they are doing remarkably well.
We planted 27 different species, and we'll be comparing species to species, which support things like larvae of butterflies and moths.
We wanted to bring in plants that we knew would fit well there, but not necessarily make it look the way that Elings did before any disruption.
This is a climate-forward restoration experiment where we're comparing locally sourced natives to some plants that we're bringing from farther south. Things like boxthorn, Shaw's agave, Forbium misera, or cliff spurge.
We're helping plants from further south that wouldn't be able to make it through the developed areas of Ventura, Oxnard, and other areas to be able to make it up the coast to Santa Barbara, which with a changing climate might be their perfect range.
Translocation and climate forward restoration is right on the front of everybody's minds. We know that things have to adapt to keep up with climate change.
Land managers across the globe are dealing with the same issues that this project is trying to solve. And that is, can you move species from one place to another?
We've been talking about this work for a long time at the garden. It's pretty progressive. There's concern that they might spread in the region and push out the local native plants, or that they might hybridize with some of the existing locals.
We also have to make sure that those plants have what they need to be successful here, which often means pollinators and dispersers of their seeds. So it's extremely multifaceted. It's something that none of us take lightly because we know that there are inherent risks to the local ecology when we bring something new in.
And we have a little bit extra leeway to do this in an urban park because it's surrounded by developed land and it's not a portal to our wildlands. So we can test this, we can study this and see, is this a valid way to go to basically be resilient to climate change?
I see so much success there. I mean, there are weeds that we're still tackling, and so it might be hard for someone not really familiar with native plants and the design to know, but there are so many plants thriving there. We did our first round of monitoring for both growth and biomass, and when we did that initial survey, about a month and a half after we finished planting, we had over 95% survival of all plants.
We're looking at an array of metrics to ask whether these different components were successful. There's survivorship of the plants, there's the growth of the plants, there's the control of the weeds, there's the amount of time and expense of the different methods. And then there's something we're gonna see as we monitor the bugs is, you know, does it affect which bugs colonize?
There's a whole litany of things that folks will be looking at and measuring over time to not only make sure that plants are surviving, but that we're actually creating a functional ecosystem, because we're trying to do more than just garden at Elings. We're trying to build habitat.
What gives me hope is projects like these that are using their best minds. They're applying science to advancing conservation. If more folks did that, if more groups did that, we're going to find the solutions. Humans, we're crafty. We can build things. We can harness the power of nature. What we haven't done is look to nature more to help provide those solutions, these nature-based solutions. And that's what this project is doing.